What's good, y'all? This your boy Black G92, back from a very fun ass vacation. For those have follow me on Snapchat, you already know. For those that don't, flew down to Miami, spent time with my dad and his fiance and her folks and all that, and also a couple people from my dad's side of family was down there too. So as a little ball, and also my little sister's down there, we had a ball throughout that whole weekend. Like every other night, it was something to do, you know what I mean? Every other night, every other afternoon, we just on go, you know what I mean? Just going places, you know what I mean? And I can just go all day about it, but I can just save that for a live stream. And also, there's some other pressing matters, more so about my shitty ass job, but I'm gonna hold off till tomorrow as well, so. Because I feel like I just got to say what's really on my mind about that fuck-ass job. But anyway, I ain't going to say, I ain't going to spend too much time talking about it, though. Because, like I said, I'm not going to, I plan on staying on a very good mood, you know what I mean? Because right now I'm going to do a reaction to this documentary made by, what's the name? What's the name of this YouTube channel? Name of this YouTube channel? Oh, fuck. Wrestle with Andy. Titled Boss Time, the Sasha Banks story, full career documentary. And a few people that have subscribed to my channel have requested me to do this video, so I finally got around to it. Shout out to all y'all that done, like, gave me this video to react to and asked me to do so. I finally got around to it, so I'm gonna see what this video is looking like in about 3, 2, 1.
Part of what makes the Four Horsewomen of Wrestling so great is that they each have something distinct that they bring to the equation.
Huh.
Becky Lynch is the biggest star, of course, and Charlotte Flair has a pedigree unlike any other.
Yeah.
On top of this, Bayley has arguably the best natural babyface connection with fans. That said, though, perhaps none of them are a better actual wrestler than Sasha Banks.
Ooh.
Yes, whether it be the ring or like in Sasha Banks segments, is like... the boss has proven herself to be one of the shining beacons of WWE during the last decade.
Okay.
And this is why, even now at just 29 years old, she's already a legend in the division.
That's
but
dope.
But how did it all happen? Well, join us today as we take a deep dive into her entire career journey so far in Boss Time, the Sasha Banks story.
I do like those like silhouette. And that's
Mercedes Justine Kaestner Vernado was born on January 26th, 1992 in Fairfield, California. And while she would spend her initial years there, it would not be her home for long as, with her brother suffering from autism, this would mean the family would have to move around regularly so as to find suitable schools and hospitals for him. And while this would take the young Mercedes to various different places over the years, eventually she would be able to lay some roots down in Boston, Massachusetts, where she would, from there, be homeschooled, with her spare time outside of her studies usually being spent listening to K-pop music and watching either her favorite anime shows or pro wrestling.
Okay.
And though she would be a fan of WWE, with the late Eddie Guerrero being a particular favorite of hers, the future boss wouldn't find much inspiration from the women's side of the sport here. No, instead, she would get this from All Japan Women's Wrestling, something she would keep up on via tapes that her family were able to locate for her.
Okay.
And this family, as it happened, was something of hip-hop royalty, as while her parents were of relatively standard middle-class stock, Mercedes was in fact first cousins with some of the biggest names in the music industry. Names that included producer Daz Dillinger, Moesha star Brandi Norwood, singer Ray J, and of course, legendary rapper Snoop Dogg. And it was Snoop who would help to feed her early interest in wrestling as, a fan of WWE himself, he would regularly take her to shows when she was a kid, with them even being in attendance at the Eddie Guerrero.
Now, when I found out, I think it was on Wikipedia, that Snoop Dogg had a cousin that was in the WWE, I was like, wow, that's cray. Like, and not to mention, it just shows that Snoop is related to damn near everybody. You know what I mean? He got a lot of cousins. You know what I mean? That is crazy, man. Like, heck. Then I can't really talk because I got a bunch of relatives as well. Some I probably haven't seen in years. You know what I mean? But anyway, that's just how life is sometimes.
Show on November 14th, 2005. Something which the youngster would talk about later on in life as being a bittersweet moment, given the fact that she didn't know Eddie had died until she got there that night. Still, getting to see her favorite pastime up close and in person was enough to feed her passion, so much that by the time she'd left school in 2008, the future women's champion would begin training in the craft herself, with her doing so at local Massachusetts promotion Chaotic Wrestling. And quickly taking to this then, she would end up making her debut soon after that, as she started going by the ring name of Mercedes KV, forming an early alliance here with fellow up-and-comer Nikki Rocks. But that wouldn't be the most noteworthy moment during this part of Mercedes' career, however, because it would also be here that, while working a number of intergender matches, she would find herself on the opposite side of the ring from Kid Mikazi, real name Sarath Tan. And these two would quickly hit it off, as it turned out, with their in-ring chemistry quickly blossoming into a romance from there, as before long, they would become an official item.
Hey.
But not satisfied with just personal life successes, Mercedes had soon made it her goal to win a world title in Chaotic Wrestling 2.
Okay.
And come December 2nd, 2011 then, after having spent some time picking up new additions to her arsenal in the likes of New England Championship Wrestling and the National Wrestling Alliance, she would finally be able to return to her home base and beat her, by then heated rival, Alexis, so as to take home the gold for the first time. After that, she would rack up successful defenses against the likes of Barbie, Luscious Latasha, and Mistress Belmont. In fact, so dominating was she here that, by the end of her reign, she would have held on to the belt for a record 259 days.
Wow,
with her only losing
that's
it
impressive.
After she was forced to vacate. The reason for
259 days, that is very impressive indeed, like to maintain that type of record. Hey, shout out to Sasha Banks.
She had been signed up to a developmental contract with WWE.
That we can fight Vought the right way, but the high road just doesn't work. We have to be as mean as they are. We have to do whatever it takes.
One shot makes
I still have not watched this third season of The Boys. I've already saw the first two seasons, and they're awesome as fuck. Like, far as a show. And I'm after. I'm going to skip this commercial.
Yes, in June of 2012, the rising star had attended a tryout camp for the New York promotion. And, impressed with
so
what
young
seen
in these
there,
photos.
WWE
photos
top
footage.
Brass had invited her to return and become part of NXT going forward, with this being the place she would learn the in-house style under the aim of eventually hitting the main roster. Of course, at this point, women's wrestling within the company was still very much stuck in the Divas era, with the biggest pushes usually being based less on skill and more on who had the most model-like looks. That would begin to change around the time of Mercedes hiring, however, as it was then that, looking to reinvigorate the division by placing more of an emphasis on wrestling, Triple H had scoured the indies, looking for the top female talent available. And as one of those top talents, the Boston Girl, who would now be rechristened as Sasha Banks, with her quickly setting out from there to prove that she was worthy of this position, as she had some great early matches against the likes of Paige and Alicia Fox. Not long after this, and she would even find herself challenging for the NXT Women's Championship. However, this was a belt she would not get to win just yet, because before she did, she would come into contact with three women who would, in many ways, go on to define her career thus far.
Okay.
Yes, well, Sasha was rising up the ranks of NXT, so were Charlotte Flair, Becky Lynch, and Bayley. And so, it only made sense that these four would soon become intertwined in storylines, as each of them were vying to be the new face of women's wrestling. And seeing her star threatening to be overshadowed around this time then, Banks would turn heel not long after this, with her from there developing her main event level gimmick of The Boss,
the
a cocky
boss.
And arrogant heel who knew full well that she was better than everyone else, and wasn't shy about showing it. But not content with just having the best gimmick on the roster, Banks would also add some backup to her ranks at this point in the form of Charlotte Flair herself, with these two from there entering into a heated feud with top babyface Bayley.
Okay.
And of course, needing some backup of her own then, Bayley would eventually forge a partnership with Becky Lynch, with all four women eventually taking part in a tag team match after that on the July 3rd, 2013 episode of NXT.
I'm gonna have
to
check this one out.
So as to finally settle their beef.
Hey.
Of course, after losing that night, Sasha and Charlotte would end up parting ways, but this would not be the end of their story as it turned out. Because in the months that followed, they would start a feud with each other, one that constantly found the other horsewomen being interweaved into it as well. At one point, Becky Lynch would turn heel too, aligning herself with the Boss after she had beaten Bayley in a match. And come December 11th's takeover, Our Evolution, Banks would even get another shot at the NXT Women's title, a title that was then being held by Flair herself. But while she wouldn't win the belt on that night either, she would put on yet another fantastic performance. One that ultimately earned
Smash
her a rematch on the January 15th, 2015 episode of the Black and Gold brand. Unfortunately, that night would end with a loss too, though, after an interference spot from Lynch led to Sasha getting disqualified at the close of the bout. And this would ultimately result in dissension forming between the two heels as, by now, it had become clear that all four would eventually have to settle things in a match. And that match would come at February 11th TakeOver Rival, where all four horsewomen would finally meet in a fatal four-way match for the NXT Women's title. Of course, it was also on that night that, finally, after pinning Charlotte at the 12.5-minute mark, the boss would reign supreme, lifting the women's title above her head at the end of the night, as she from there proclaimed herself to be the champion. After that, she would further prove that she was the best as she put on a string of excellent title defenses against the likes of Alexa Bliss and Becky Lynch. In fact, by then, her reputation was beginning to grow so much that, despite being a heel, many fans had actually started cheering for her, with her in-ring skills being too much for them to ignore. Allegedly, the legendary Shawn Michaels, arguably the greatest wrestler of all time, would even tell Banks backstage one night around this time that she was his favorite performer on the roster. And of course, this all led to her making history not long after this when, at the August 22nd TakeOver Brooklyn show, the boss would face off against Bayley, with the two from there going on to have arguably the greatest match in NXT history, and certainly the greatest women's match ever seen in a WWE ring at that point. And while on that night Sasha would lose, this ending her title reign at 192 days, things would not end there.
And 192 days is like not a small feat for certain. 192 is still a good like run and bouts of wins, you know what I mean? So, hey, it wasn't a complete loss, that match was, but hey, things happen.
As a result of the massive amounts of praise that was later heaped on the bout by both critics and fans, a rematch would be set for October 7th's TakeOver Respect, with this one not only being the first Iron Woman match in WWE history, but also the first time the women would ever main event a WWE-promoted pay-per-view event. Before that match could happen, though, Banks would shock the wrestling world when, on the July 13th, 2015 episode of Raw, she, alongside Charlotte Flair and Becky Lynch, would be called up to the main roster as part of what Stephanie McMahon had labeled the Divas Revolution, an attempt by the company to give more focus to the women's division after a backlash had begun forming online around the treatment it had been receiving.
These damned commercials. I might make this a two-part, but...
And while there were definitely some bumps in the road getting things going during those early days, Sasha would immediately be treated as a superstar by fans as, despite remaining a heel at this point, her matches would regularly be drowned out by a sea of people chanting her name, chants which would only get louder after she'd returned to NXT in October to have her aforementioned Iron Woman match with Bayley. This being the one that was arguably even better than their first, and saw the hugger come out the winner by the end at 3-2.
That arm submission.
Once that was over, though, Banks became fully targeted on the main roster once again, where she hoped to change perceptions of what women's wrestling could be, just as she already had in NXT. This is what would see her form a trio with Naomi and Tamina called Team Bad in the months that followed then, backing up win after win with them until eventually, come the time of the 2016 Royal Rumble, she would have turned face and become part of the Raw Divas title picture alongside Charlotte and Becky. And this battle to see who was the best would eventually get blown off at WrestleMania 32 on April 3rd of that year, where in front of WWE's legit biggest ever crowd, Sasha would come out to a hero's response, being sung to the ring by her cousin Snoop Dogg, and
that's
looking
dope.
Like an absolute superstar in the process,
I bet.
As she adorned herself in Eddie Guerrero-inspired ring gear. Of course, most people assumed that, given how over she was getting at this point, this night would be the perfect one to finally coronate her as the top star in the division. Unfortunately, though, it would end up being Charlotte who picked up the win by the end, becoming the new Raw Women's Champion, as from there, Sasha was forced to enter recovery mode while she regrouped and began making plans for what she would do next. And part of these plans would be to get married, as it happened, because while taking a sabbatical after WrestleMania, she would tie the knot with Sarath Tan, the two making the hectic life of being active wrestlers work for them from there, as Sarath would retire from the ring around this time so as to become a backstage costume designer for WWE.
That's
this
dope.
Allowing him to travel on
they
the road
so
with his
together.
New wife and see her on a daily basis.
Aww.
Back in the ring, though, Sasha would soon be ready to make her triumphant return, with her eventually coming back in June that year to restart her feud with Charlotte Flair, who had by then picked up a lackey in the form of Dana Brooke. And wanting to even the score then, the boss would bring in some backup of her own for a tag match against Flair and Brooke at July 24th's Battleground, with this surprise teammate ending up being her old friend Bayley. Yes, while all four of the horsewomen shared a close friendship with each other by this point, a particularly strong bond would have developed between Banks and the Hugger. And so now, getting a chance to reunite with her bestie then, the Boston girl felt all the more motivated to finally dethrone Charlotte as the Raw Women's Champion, with this being something she would eventually do on the July 25th episode of
that's
Raw,
painful.
Taking home the top prize for the first time in the process. Unfortunately,
you're
however,
so happy.
This would start a repeated trend that saw Sasha able to win titles just fine, but not be able to defend them successfully when push came to shove. And so, with this in mind then, she would lose the belt back to the Queen just 27 days later, as from there, the two traded it back and forth for the rest of the summer, breaking some more new ground in the process, as they would not only have the first ever women's Hell in a Cell match at that October's titular pay-per-view, but also the first women's main event on the main roster.
In the end,
though, despite Banks being a three-time champion by the time this feud had run its course at the turn of the year, it would end up being Charlotte who came out on top overall, as she would win the blow-off match between the two at December 18th's Roadblock End of the Line. Moving on for the time being, then, Sasha next segued into a program with Nia Jax, while Bayley took on the champ instead, with this ultimately leading to a fatal four-way match between all women involved at WrestleMania 33. And after that, the boss would reset her sights on becoming the Raw Women's Champion again, challenging the then-title holder Alexa Bliss at August 20th, 2017's SummerSlam pay-per-view.
That's fairly recent.
Of course, what made this match all the more interesting was that, at the time, there was rumored real-life heat between the two, something which had been spurred on by a series of passive-aggressive tweets they had thrown at each other in the weeks previous. Ultimately, when things finally got in the ring...
Something tells me that Alexa Bliss seemed like the type that would throw some passive-aggressive shots at people, like, just from her facial expressions, you know what I mean? not to say too much, but just from the look of her face, like, yeah, I could definitely tell she has that personality.
Main professional, and Sasha would even get the win by the end so as to pick up her fourth world title on the main roster. Of course, the curse of her failed title defenses would come back to bite her just 8 days later, however, as it would be then, during the rematch with Bliss, that she would lose the belt once more. And so now, out of the title picture again, the former champion began teaming up with Bayley as the two started a feud with Absolution, during which time their team became such a hit with fans that they began demanding the company introduce women's tag team titles so as to reward the hard work that both they and other teams were putting out. Before that would happen, though, Banks would spend the start of 2018 racking up even more firsts when she became the inaugural entrant in the first-ever Women's Royal Rumble match that January, lasting almost an hour in the ring that night before being eliminated. And after that, she would take part in the first-ever Women's Elimination Chamber a month later, too, with this being the bout that would see cracks begin to form in the bond between her and Bayley. Yes, it seemed like the two were finally headed for a breakup, and in the weeks that followed, WWE would tease this even further, as they had a number of brawls together, with this all leading to them being sent to a counselor together where, in a series of skits, they would ultimately mend fences and reunite, the duo now formally going by the name of the Boss and Hug Connection going forward, a reference to the legendary Rock and Sock duo from the late 90s. And so now, on the same page once more then, the Boss and Hug Connection would once again rise up the tag team ranks, with this eventually seeing them get a spot in the February 17th Elimination Chamber match to crown the inaugural Women's Tag Team Champions, a match they would of course win as they from there started their reign at the top. Sadly though, come WrestleMania 35 in April of that year, they would lose these belts to the Iconics, with this being something that allegedly left the two feeling disheartened backstage, as they believed that there was still so much they could do during the run to establish the new titles. But of course, the truth was, it wasn't just this incident that had caused Sasha to get upset, as she'd been feeling burned out for quite a while before that. Hell, even when she'd gotten to challenge Ronda Rousey for the Raw Women's title earlier that year, there seemed to be a spark missing from her eyes that had been there back in her NXT days.
That was why,
after Mania 35, the boss would go directly to Vince McMahon and ask for a release from her contract. Not willing to throw away one of his biggest female stars so easily, however, Vince would instead tell her to take an extended hiatus away from TV so she could deal with the depression and depersonalization that she was going through.
Yeah, sometimes you all need a break from something you've been working on. Everyone needs a break. Whatever that is that they're focused on for like a good amount of years.
And this time off turned out to be exactly what she needed, as it happened, because come August 12th of that year, she would return to TV once more. Now shifting her alignment to the side of the heels, as for the first time on the main roster, the brilliant villainy of the boss that had gotten her so over in NXT could finally be unleashed on Raw. Of course, many saw this change in attitude coming, but what they didn't see was that the perennial babyface Bayley would also turn heel not long after this too, with the two friends from there resuming their partnership, only now from the dark side, as they became the scourge of the women's division on both the red and blue brands for the next couple of years. And as if that wasn't enough, the girl from Boston would also get some mainstream shine around this time too, when she got cast in season 2 of The Mandalorian.
What?
There, playing the role of Koska Reeves, a role she would pick up after director Jon Favreau had seen her on an episode of the YouTube show Hot Ones and felt that she had the star power he was looking for.
I'm about to check out Mandalorian
back in
now.
The ring, though, and things were about to get even better as, while the world was about to go into shutdown and many in wrestling were set to feel the struggle like never before as they had to suddenly adapt to performing in front of empty arenas for the foreseeable future, the boss and the hugger actually managed to have arguably the best run of their career up to that point, with them regularly becoming the highlight of SmackDown and occasionally Raw every week for the first half of 2020, as their excellent character segments and always impressive matches made the show worth watching during a period when it was often hardest to watch. And recognizing this great work then, WWE bosses would soon have the two dripping in gold, as by the end of July, Banks and Bayley would not only hold the tag team titles, but also the Raw and SmackDown women's titles, the latter of course being held by the boss, and the former by the hugger.
Okay.
But as with all great teams in WWE, it was inevitable that it would all end up in a breakup before long.
Oh.
And this breakup would eventually come when, after losing the tag titles at August 30th's Payback, Bayley turned on Sasha, with the two from there going on to have a showdown inside Hell in a Cell just a few weeks later, as the boss got her revenge by dethroning her former partner to win the SmackDown women's title. And so now, fully established as the top dog in the division once more, Sasha would go on a string of successful title defenses over the remainder of the year. All this before she would finally fall in the crosshairs of the 2021 Women's Royal Rumble winner, Bianca Belair.
Uh-oh.
What followed this would perhaps be Banks' greatest achievement to date, as on April 9th of that year, at Night 1 of WrestleMania 36, the first WWE show to feature fans in attendance for over a year at that point, she would become part of only the second ever Women's WrestleMania main event, playing the role of the heel perfectly there as she fell to Belair by the end, making a star out of her, and having arguably the best match of the evening in the process. After that, she took some more time off of TV, eventually returning in the summer to resume her past feuds with both Bianca and Becky Lynch, as the three have now found themselves locked in a battle for the SmackDown women's title once more.
Ooh.
What happens next is anyone's guess, but we can guarantee one thing for sure. When all is said and done, Sasha Banks might very well go down as the greatest women's performer in WWE history. Someone who's achieved so many firsts at this point that she's probably lost count, and who has had the distinction of putting on what are among not just the best women's matches in WWE history, but the best matches in general, along with Bayley on NXT. So with all this in mind then, it seems like there's very little doubting the fact that, from now until whenever she chooses to stop doing this, whenever she appears on WWE TV, it'll always be Boss Time.
Boss Time.
Well, guys, what did you think of the video? Let us know in the comments
below.
Oh,
I like this one. I very much enjoyed it, like the other ones I've watched.
Subscribe to the channel, as well as follow Wrestling with Andy on Instagram and Twitter.
All right, that was Boss Time, the Sasha Banks story. It was a very good documentary. It showcased all the highlights and, of course, her beginnings and what may have you. And, of course, all the different wins and losses, which is quite a bit. It's like, it just shows you that that career in this industry is just, man, it has a lot of twists and turns and wins and losses. And all that depends on how well you bounce back from all that, from like all the losses, and have the wins like matter that much more than said losses, you know what I mean? And not to mention like all those firsts I done seen, like, and it shows not only just Sasha Banks, but female wrestlers have came a long, well, women wrestlers have came a long way. That's impressive within a decade or two, you know what I mean? That is impressive. Indeed. Let's see what the people say in the comments. Whether they like her or not, it's denying that Sasha Banks is one of the greatest female wrestlers to ever lace up a pair of boots. Okay, I see someone showing love. What if you make her opponents look like $1 million looking good herself? Shines whenever you match. Matches make everyone she steps in the ring with shine just as much. But I will say for the ever top star status, because win or lose remains a boss. Her moniker boss, very fitting indeed, because based on her entries like showcased in this documentary, very fitting. She does have a good sense of style and presence and aura. So I'm definitely looking forward to seeing like some requests of like her matches and such like that, or some of her highlighted matches mentioned in this documentary. So let me know in the comment section. And also, if this is your first time watching this reaction video, be sure to hit that like button, hit that notification button, hit that subscribe button. And also, if you want me to react to any sort of music videos, songs, movie countdowns, movie clips, analysis videos, movie Netflix or streaming show, streaming trailers, or interviews from just anybody you think of, or just news going on in the crazy ass world, be sure to post them in the comment section below. And also be sure to follow me on my social media accounts, which will be posted in the description box below. And also, if you're able to, hit that donation link to my Cash App if you're able to help support the channel further while we proceed on this road of 1K subscribers. And I'm very appreciative of you guys, and is much better than have to deal with the bullshit at my shitty ass job. So be prepared for a live stream for that tomorrow. For real though, because I got a lot to say about that shit, and I won't be there for too long. Won't take too much of your time on a live stream. This is your boy Black G92 about to sign off. How is your boy? Peace.